Leia here from leiafirstsci.com/MCAT, and in this video, we'll start with an introduction to red blood cells and hemoglobin. You can find this entire series by visiting my website, leiafirstsci.com/hemoglobin. You'll be required to study many different metabolic pathways for the MCAT, but you don't want to study them individually. You want to understand how they all tie together. And when it comes to oxygen, that is a key component that ties everything together, because oxygen is what allows us to survive as multicellular organisms by allowing us to produce much higher levels of energy compared to what the individual cells are capable of producing anaerobically. Let's look at survival starting with glucose. We eat, we digest the glucose, and we break it down into two molecules of pyruvate in order to harvest some energy through the process of glycolysis. But we don't get that much energy from glycolysis. Instead, we take the molecules of pyruvate and we break them down ultimately into carbon dioxide through the Krebs cycle, which still doesn't give us that much energy. But in the process of breaking down the pyruvate in the Krebs cycle, we harvest high energy electrons, which are carried as NADH and FADH2. Those electrons are taken to the electron transport chain and turned into energy through oxidative phosphorylation. In order to keep the electron transport chain going, we need a molecule to accept those electrons, and that's where oxygen comes in. Oxygen is a terminal electron acceptor which binds to those electrons, binds to protons, and is released as water. Without the oxygen, the entire electron transport chain will stop, the Krebs cycle will stop, and suddenly the production of ATP is slowed down. ATP is the energy currency of the cell. That is how you pay for all the metabolic reactions, and that is how you have energy to do what's required to survive. Now that you see why oxygen is so important, let's see how it gets to the cells. When you breathe in air, you get oxygen and many other gases, but let's focus on the oxygen. It enters the lungs, and from the lungs, it gets picked up by the red blood cell, which will transport it to the rest of the body. The red blood cells are also known as erythrocytes, where erythros comes from the word red, and cyte is cell. The red blood cell is a biconcave disc, and I like to think of it as the lifesaver candy, but without a hole in the middle. So it looks like a tube that you can sit on, and that tube will go through the bloodstream, helping to transport oxygen. The red blood cell is a very interesting cell. Like all the other cells in your body, it has the lipid bilayer, and then it has the cytosol, but what it doesn't have is mitochondria, and it doesn't have a nucleus. When the red blood cells are made in the bone marrow, they do have a nucleus. That would be the pre-red blood cell, because the nucleus has DNA, and DNA codes for proteins, and proteins will carry out the functions that a growing cell needs to grow. But as the red blood cell matures, it has to lose its nucleus so that it'll have more space to carry a very, very critical protein, and that is hemoglobin. The other critical thing lacking is mitochondria. If you think of mitochondria as the powerhouse of the cell, that's where the bulk of the ATP in the cell is being made, but the mitochondria, which has the electron transport chain, requires oxygen. Do you really want the cell that carries oxygen to other cells to potentially eat up the oxygen along the way? I don't think so. So the red blood cells will rely on glycolysis for their energy so that they can focus on the very simple task of just carrying oxygen to the other cells. And if the cell isn't taken up by a nucleus and isn't taken up by a mitochondria, it has so much more room for hemoglobin, which is what we really care about. In fact, about 35% of the red blood cell is occupied by hemoglobin, which you can write as HGB or simply HB. And what's so special about hemoglobin? Hemoglobin is the protein that physically carries the oxygen. Hemoglobin is a very interesting protein, and it's one of the most studied proteins. It comes from the word hemo, which refers to the heme prosthetic group which you have in that molecule, and globin, which is a globular or just blob of a protein. Adult hemoglobin is a tetramer of alpha-2, beta-2 subunits. Tetramer means that it has tetra four subunits, two of them are alpha and two of them are beta. So if you think of the structure of a protein, the tertiary structure would be the alpha polypeptide chain or the beta polypeptide chain, but the quaternary structure, that ultimate three-dimensional structure, comes from all four subunits being connected to make one giant globular protein. Let's contrast this with fetal hemoglobin, which is alpha 2 gamma 2, and that is critical to allowing the fetus to get oxygen from the parent, but more on that later. I drew a scribbled version of the hemoglobin molecule just to give you an idea of what we're looking at. Notice we have two red and two blue subunits representing the alpha and the beta. And let's pretend that they're very similar to each other. Notice you see a lot of alpha helical structures in its secondary structure, and that it's pretty much a giant blob. The black circle at the center of each subunit represents the porphyrin ring. This is a prosthetic group, meaning it's not made up of amino acids, but it's bound to the protein to help with structure or function. And in this case, the porphyrin ring, which is the heme group, is critical because this is where you bind iron, and iron in turn will bind oxygen, and oxygen is the ultimate goal of the hemoglobin molecule. I also want you to notice this nice hole in the center of the hemoglobin, and that's going to be critical when we talk about the binding of 2,3-BPG. Here's a close-up of the heme group. Notice that you have the iron 2 plus in the center, bound to four nitrogens in the imidazole ring. Imidazole comes from the amino acid histidine, and this entire thing is bound to a histidine, which is on the polypeptide chain, and that will be critical for the structure later on. In addition to binding the four nitrogen atoms, the iron will also bind O2. If you think of the structure of oxygen, we have oxygen double bound to another oxygen atoms, two pi bonds, and two lone pairs. This is the ideal molecule that iron wants to bind, but there are other competitive ligands that can try to bind in there. For example, carbon monoxide is a poison. Let's see why. If we draw the structure for carbon monoxide, or CO, you'll notice it looks very similar to oxygen. It's two atoms directly bound to each other with sigma and pi bonds, and even though the molecule has a net neutral charge, don't let this trick you. If you run a quick formal charge, oxygen should have six electrons directly bound, and here we have only five. Six minus five is plus one, which is not what we're concerned with. But carbon, which should have only four bound electrons, has five. And four minus five is minus one. That negative carbon will trick heme into getting bound instead of oxygen. But because of the negative charge, it doesn't want to leave. Carbon monoxide has a 250 times stronger affinity for the heme group than does oxygen, which means that if a carbon monoxide gets in, it's very hard for an oxygen to kick it out. Cyanide is another similar structure that also binds competitively. Cyanide is CN minus. The only difference between carbon monoxide and cyanide is that even though carbon has a negative one charge, nitrogen is neutral because it wants five electrons and it has five electrons. Based on this, you can imagine that cyanide is also a poison. Looking at this heme group, notice all the pi bonds that you have. This is an aromatic system. Remember that one of the characteristics of aromaticity is planar or flat. But when this heme group does not have oxygen bound, it tends to look a little domed or puckered. Hemoglobin doesn't necessarily like binding oxygen, and this is called the T state, which stands for taut. It's so taut, it's so tight, it doesn't want to allow an oxygen into this group. But if hemoglobin is in the lungs and there is a very high concentration of oxygen, that sheer volume or pressure of O2 is going to force one of the O2 molecules to bind. This will take that dome shape and flatten it out back into the structure that we see here. And this puts the hemoglobin into the R state, which is much more relaxed. It's so relaxed, it doesn't mind binding oxygen. So when one of the heme groups binds to oxygen, and it becomes more relaxed, what happens is you get a very, very slight movement in the molecule when it goes from dome to flat. It pulls up on the histidine, which pulls that entire molecule, and we're talking less than an angstrom. And if you remember, an angstrom is 1 times 10 to the minus 10 meters. It's a tiny, tiny change, But this induces the next subunit on hemoglobin to change, and the next one, and the next one, and suddenly they all want to start binding oxygen. So you go from hemoglobin that doesn't like oxygen to a hemoglobin that is desperate for oxygen. This concept is called cooperative binding, or simply cooperativity. And I think of this as peer pressure. Just imagine a bunch of kids standing in front of a lake, and they want to go swimming, but no one wants to be the first one jumping in. So they say, you jump in first. No, you jump in first. And then finally you have one kid that just gets pushed in, and he gets in the water, and suddenly, doesn't look so bad. Now they all want to jump in. One oxygen binds when it doesn't want to, goes from T to R state, and now they all want to bind. And this is great in the lungs because you need hemoglobin to pick up that oxygen so that it can go to the rest of the cells. In addition to oxygen binding to iron and the competitive inhibitors like carbon monoxide and cyanide, there are also allosteric molecules that can bind to hemoglobin. Remember that allo means other, and when you have an allosteric ligand, it's something that binds to a non-active site. If you're thinking of an enzyme, hemoglobin is a protein, not an enzyme, but it still has allosteric binding sites which are not specifically on the heme group. These ligands can influence the hemoglobin's ability to take up oxygen or release oxygen. The molecules that will bind at the allosteric site include protons, and this will come from having a low pH, carbon dioxide, which is released by the cells from respiration, and 2,3-BPG, which is another very interesting molecule. Not only will they affect hemoglobin's ability to bind oxygen, but they're also going to change the way we look at the hemoglobin curve. And that's exactly what we'll discuss in the next video, which you can find along with this entire series by visiting my website, layerforsci.com/hemoglobin. Are you stuck on a specific MCAT topic? I offer private online tutoring where I focus on your needs to strengthen your individual weaknesses. Tutoring details can be found using the link below, or by visiting my website, layerforsci.com/MCAT tutor. Are you overwhelmed by the sheer volume of information required for the MCAT? Are you worried that lack of a proper study plan and low MCAT score will prevent you from getting into medical school? My new ebook, The MCAT Exam Strategy, a 6-week guide to crushing the MCAT, will help you formulate a concrete study plan by helping you figure out where you stand now, identify your goals, and figure out what it takes to reach them. And it's yours free when you sign up for my email newsletter at MCATExamStrategy.com. By signing up for my email newsletter, you'll also be the first to know when I have new videos, MCAT study guides, cheat sheets, tips, and so much more. The link again, MCATExamStrategy.com.